So now let's get into how we're actually going to use these. Now, I mentioned the genome is kind of like the entire cookbook, and each gene is an individual recipe cards, and the proteins produced are the food. The genotype is all the genes an individual carries for that particular trait. So we're looking at what are the two, and if we're talking about humans, what are the two versions of that recipe that we have in our cookbook? And the phenotype is the physical manifestation of those traits, meaning what is the end result? What version of that recipe are we ultimately making using our cookbook? But how do we go from genotype to phenotype? What's the process of actually using that DNA to make the end product, a protein? So let's look at how genes work in an overview. Now, this process we're looking at is called the central dogma of biology, that we go from DNA to RNA to protein in that order. But let's simplify it down and create a more familiar example that we can follow. So we're inside the nucleus. We are looking at the DNA and the genes in its entirety, which would be something like your grandma's cookbook. But grandma doesn't want her cookbooks to leave her kitchen because they're her cookbooks. So in order to do anything with this information, we're gonna have to write down our own copy. So consider that you go to your grandmother's kitchen and you have an index card and you copy the recipe down onto an index card. Since you've copied this down in a simpler, easy to transport format, you can take that index card with you. And you can take it to your own kitchen where you can then go through and bring your ingredients together, bring all the things you need together, put them together and bake whatever it is you're trying to bake or cook, and get your end product, in this case, chocolate chip cookies. We follow a similar process going from DNA to RNA to protein. Only instead of cookbooks and recipe cards, we're going through two processes called transcription and translation. Transcription specifically is taking the gene sequence, copying it from DNA to a middleman molecule we called mRNA or messenger RNA. This is all happening on the inside of the nucleus since the DNA is trapped in the nucleus. We can then take that mRNA and transport it out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm, where we can then go through translation. Translation is the actual protein building process. We take the sequence of the gene that we've encoded in the mRNA and direct the production of the protein itself using other molecules to help along. So how does the sequence of DNA bases determine which proteins are made? We go through transcription, where DNA serves as a template to produce mRNA, and that mRNA carries the DNA's message from the nucleus to the cytoplasm. We're keeping the language the same, going from a nucleic acid to a nucleic acid. So DNA, or deoxyribonucleic acid, is used as a template to form mRNA, or messenger ribonucleic acid. Let's go through each of the steps. So step one, we have to recognize and bind. So once RNA polymerase, which is an enzyme that's going to build RNA, recognizes a specific promoter site, which is going to serve as kind of like our start point, we can jump on to the DNA molecule. RNA polymerase is going to, quote, read the DNA molecule. As it goes along and reads the DNA molecule, it's going to build a single-stranded RNA copy called the mRNA transcript. So it's looking at each of the bases and it's adding the complementary base on the other side. So if this was an A, a T, a C, and a G, then on the other side we would have a U, an A, a G, and a C. It's important to note that the alphabet's almost exactly the same. The only difference is that RNA uses uracil instead of thymine. So anywhere where DNA would use a thymine, RNA is going to use uracil in its place. But other than that, it's pretty much the same. Once we've reached the end of the gene, we terminate this process. We reach a stop point and RNA polymerase lets go. We then have this single-stranded piece of RNA, and we have to give it a little bit of extra editing before it can leave. So we put something like a cap on the front and a poly A tail on the end. This is so that we know later on where the beginning is, as well as promoting or protecting the end as well. We can also remove sections that don't code for anything. So it's important to note that a gene is not necessarily a continuous segment that codes for something. Sometimes there are pieces called introns that we have to remove. We remove those non-coding sections and stitch together the parts that do code. Now that we've gone through that process, we can take that mRNA and pump it out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm. The next step is translation. Now, translation is where we use the ribosomes. If you remember from an earlier unit, we talked about how ribosomes were little protein factories. This is that part, we're getting into the details of that. So we have to decode the mRNA message into what we call an amino acid sequence or a polypeptide, which means we're now changing the language. We're going from a nucleotide-based language to an amino acid-based language. So we started with DNA, we go through transcription to form mRNA, and then for translation, we go from mRNA to a protein, the central dogma of biology. In translation, we're doing the actual building process. Now remember, we had that little tab, that little marker in the front to say this is the beginning. And we also have a specific set of bases that are going to signal the beginning called A, U, and G. We're adenine, uracil, and guanine. This is recognized as a start point or the start sequence. It's going to help bring the ribosome to the mRNA molecule, as well as bring the first tRNA molecule or transfer RNA. Transfer RNA is a special type of RNA that's going to bring the appropriate amino acid to the ribosome. We then start to elongate. So the ribosome will move from the beginning of the mRNA section all the way to the end until we reach a stop sequence. As it does that, we're reading the mRNA molecule in groups of three. We call these groups of three codons. And the tRNA molecule on the other end has the complementary three base pairs. So if our start sequence is AUG, then our tRNA will have UAC, since those are the complementary base pair rules. We go through this process going three nucleotides at a time, each three nucleotides coding for a specific amino acid. And as we go down the line, we will add those new amino acids to a chain. When we reach a stop sequence, we terminate the process because the protein we've assembled is now complete. When that happens, the protein and the mRNA molecule are released from the ribosome, and the ribosome can move on to another mRNA molecule. Now, we can take that same mRNA chain or same length of mRNA and use it over and over and over again before it finally is degraded, making dozens or hundreds of molecules of the protein before it's finally stopped. Now, like I mentioned earlier, there's some slight differences in DNA and RNA in terms of base pairing. When we looked at DNA, A's went with T's and T's went with A's, G's went with C's and C's went with G's. However, in RNA, we're switching out the T's for a uracil, a U. So A pairs with U and U pairs with A, and the G's and C's stay the same. That's our difference. Anywhere where you would see a thymine, you're going to be replacing it with a uracil when you go from DNA to RNA. So going back and kind of recapping with translation, we have tRNA, which is transfer RNA. It's going to translate the message from the mRNA to the amino acid sequence we need. And so tRNA is going to carry those amino acids that will become part of our new protein chain. The attachment site is called the anticodon. So the three bases we have in the mRNA is called the codon, and the tRNA has the anticodon. Codons and anticodons are complementary to each other. So if the codon is AUG, The anticodon will be UAC. We're following the complementary base pair rules we saw in the previous slide. Protein synthesis is the process of that ribosome reading this mRNA and bringing the appropriate tRNA molecules in, translating it into an amino acid sequence. So let's look at the codon and the anticodon. So the codon is, again, we're grouped in three nucleotides at a time. And it's the three different bases that are going to tell us which tRNA and which amino acid are going to come next. The attachment site has the anticodon that is complementary to the codon. And here's just a few different versions of tRNA and what they look like. And we see the anticodon down here. So here's our 2D structure, our 3D structure, and the space fill model. Now, codons are specific to which amino acid they can form. We can look at a codon table like this to determine what a codon will lead to based on the first, second, and third nucleotides in the sequence. So let's say our codon is CCA. If our codon is CCA, we start with our first C here. We go over to our second C here, CCA, which gives us proline. If you notice though, proline can be coded by CCU, CCC, and CCG. So it's important to note that while in a certain codon will only give you one amino acid, you can have multiple codons give you the same amino acid. And that's because there are more combinations of nucleotides than there are amino acids. There's only about 20 amino acids in total, and there's well over 20 different combinations of these three different positions with the four different letters. So if you're looking for a proline, CCU, CCAC, CCA, and CCG could all potentially code for that, but CCA, the one that we were looking at, will only give you proline. You'll never see CCA give you something like leucine or alanine. It'll always be that one amino acid. So consider taking some time to complete the table below. I'm not going to lengthen this video out, so I would hit pause here and see how you do with these sequences. It's important to note that every living organism uses the exact same genetic code. So no matter who you're looking at, humans, yeast, bacteria, we're using that same basic process. There might be some slight differences between bacteriotes, but overall, we're using the same exact setup. And we can use that to our advantage. We'll talk about that in biotechnology, and we'll look at kind of some of the ways we can use this to our advantage. But it's important to know that the genetic code specifies the mRNA codons, not the anticodons. The anticodon is part of the tRNA, and it already has the amino acid. The anticode is looking for the appropriate codon. So the codons dictate which amino acid comes next, not the tRNA and not the anticodon. So there are 64 different combinations of those three bases, which means 64 tRNA molecules. But again, there's only 20 amino acids, meaning you're bound to have some codons code for the same amino acid. We call this redundancy. And it also helps make sure that if there's a small mistake in the DNA, that it's not going to cause any long-term problems. So if your CCA changes to a CCC, like we saw earlier, you don't actually change anything in the end result. You end up with the exact same protein with the exact same amino acids. So think of that redundancy as a form of protection, so that if somehow a small mistake squeaks by, you're not going to totally have destruction or chaos going on inside the cell.